Let's cross down live to a man that knows more about history of Ipswich than Paul Basali and the rest of them. What?
Don't get
that. Let's talk to Harold the H. Ark, 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 peacock.
Hey, Danny, how you going?
Yes, well, you do know a lot, and some of the stories in your little Facebook thing called historyoutthere.com, you come up with some great yarns. We get a lot of great feedback, but you're going to tell us about a real-life day of zombies in Ipswich in 1928, right? My parents were born in 1929, so this is 93 years ago. 92.
So this could have something to do with their birth, because it's another true story from the amazing history of Ipswich. So if this zombie was just before they're born, you know, 9 months before they're born, who knows what story? You could be a descendant.
Anyway,
so I guess the timing of it, just work this out, work backwards. It was in the middle of February 1928,
right.
And Arthur Anderson and his sisters, Mary and Evelyn, mourned the passing of their father. They'd buried their brother James at Brisbane's Toong Cemetery just 18 months earlier, and now they were tendering another grave there. This time it was their 64-year-old father, John Clayton Anderson.
Right.
Now, John had died in a mysterious circumstances. He was found on the morning of 29th of December 1927. He was lying in long grass in Albert Park in Brisbane with a bullet wound and an automatic pistol in one hand. No one had heard the shot.
Hold it. Dun, 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 dun.
And at first, no one knew who he was. And so he was buried in a pauper's grave at Toong in Brisbane, and for months afterwards, a police photograph was circulated around the state.
Now, hold it.
This is going to take us forever. Come on.
This is going to take forever. This is just your family tree we're talking about here. Now, John was a distinguished-looking gentleman, much like yourself. He was 6 foot tall, a wiry 10 stone, and sported a grey beard and moustache. And he was well-dressed when he was found. He was wearing a grey suit with a gabardine overcoat, grey felt hat, black boots, celluloid collar and a black tie. Now, finally, after 2 months, his three children positively identified the father. Another man, Irishman Jimmy Wire, who was a friend of John's, who'd worked with him in the State Lands Department, also identified. So four positive identifications. And it was a sad and mysterious end for someone who'd worked for the government for 20 years as a draftsman. And so the family mourned, friends expressed sympathy, and the police file was closed.
Wow.
But then, Danny, it got really weird.
Wow.
Because almost 6 months after he died, stories began to circulate that the dead man was seen walking the streets of Ipswich. This was a real-life Ipswich zombie. Now, finally, a man who had known John Anderson when he was alive approached the zombie during the day and engaged in conversation. The man told the alleged John Anderson of his mysterious death and his burial, but the dead man denied everything and left. But the friend refused to accept that he'd actually been talking to a dead man, and so he went to the Ipswich Police Station here in East Street. That's where he told his story to a sceptical police sergeant, but the police files reopened and further inquiries were made. The alleged dead John Anderson was interviewed, and it was found that there was absolutely no doubt he was actually alive. And so the real John Anderson had been living and working in Carrabin on the north side of Ipswich, while everyone around him mourned. There'd actually been a zombie walking the streets of Ipswich for 6 months, and no one had noticed.
Is this true?
This is absolutely true. Now, the dead John Anderson was never identified, but the real John Anderson, he died for a second time just 3 years later when he was found in a boarding house in Spring Hill, and his children and friends had to mourn him once again. Now, what was really weird, when he was buried in a pauper's grave at Toong, right by where he was buried the first time.
Peter's got goosebumps. Dun, 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 dun.
But Danny, how can a zombie walk the streets of Ipswich for 6 months and no one notice?
Well, we can talk about that another subject matter. Now, you got historyoutthere.com, and this story will be on there tomorrow.
That's right, tomorrow morning, and there's a photo of the dead body, John Anderson. So if anyone recognises him, let us know, because he's never been identified.
Wow, and look, I got something on Facebook from Susan Jessen from Lost Ipswich, and it shows a photograph of a man, Give Jimmy a Vote, He's got a moustache. He looks very distinguished. In fact, he looks a bit like the old Wyatt Earp. He says, I found this in the old family Bible of my father's family. George lived at Bundamba. It may be silk, this actual thing with his picture on it. Give Jimmy a vote. Can anyone advise who Jimmy was and when? Thank you. And I've sent it to you. There it is there. Look, give Jimmy a vote.
Oh,
he's a distinguished man.
It looks like Wyatt Earp, yeah.
Okay, Jimmy in Bundamba, I would say he's a Labor politician that represented Bundamba in the state parliament. There was a couple of Jimmys in that period.
Well, you look into that and get back to Susan Jensen. HistoryOutThere.com, another great story about a zombie. There's one walking past the studio in that security camera. Look now. On West Bremer Radio, it's 8:19.